The Downward Spiral. The Downward Spiral is the second studio album by American industrial rock band Nine Inch Nails, released on March 8, 1994, by Nothing Records and Interscope Records in the United States and by Island Records in Europe. It is a concept album detailing the destruction of a man from the beginning of his downward spiral to his death by suicide. The Downward Spiral features elements of industrial rock, techno and heavy metal music, in contrast to the band's synth-pop-influenced debut album Pretty Hate Machine, 1989, and was produced by Nine Inch Nails frontman Trent Reznor and Flood. The Downward Spiral was conceived after the Lollapalooza 1991 festival tour as a pivot for Reznor's personal issues and the negative vibe felt by the band. The following year, Reznor moved to 10050 Cello Drive in Benedict Canyon, Los Angeles, where actress Sharon Tate was murdered by members of the Manson family. It was used as a studio called Le Pig for recording Broken, 1992, and The Downward Spiral with collaborations from other musicians. The album was influenced by late 1970s rock music albums such as David Bowie's Low and Pink Floyd's The Wall in particular, and focused on texture and space. The album spawned two singles, March of the Pigs and Closer, in addition to the promotional singles Piggy and Hurt. March of the Pigs and Closer were accompanied by music videos, with the former shot twice and the latter's heavily censored. The Downward Spiral was a major commercial success, and established Nine Inch Nails as a reputable force in the 1990s music scene, with its sound being widely imitated and Reznor receiving media hype and multiple honors, while diverging into drug abuse and depression. It has been regarded by music critics and audiences as one of the most important albums of the 1990s, and was praised for its abrasive and eclectic nature and dark themes, although it was scrutinized by social conservatives for some of its lyrics. A remix album titled Further Down the Spiral was released in 1995. The Downward Spiral was conceived after the Lollapalooza festival tour as Trent Reznor thought of a negative vibe felt by the band when they were in a European hotel. Nine Inch Nails' live performances were known for its aggressive onstage dynamic, in which band members act angry, injure themselves, and destroy instruments. Reznor had a feud with TVT Records that resulted in him co-founding Nothing Records with his former manager John Malm Jr. and signing with Interscope. He wanted to explore a fictional character whose life is psychologically wounded and developed a concept about the album's themes. He later used the concept as lyrics. The concept was based on Reznor's social issues at the time. He had personal conflicts with band member Richard Patrick and was known for enjoying alcohol. When developing The Downward Spiral, Reznor struggled with drug addiction and was depressed. Ash wrote songs related to personal issues. His friends suggested that he could take Prozac, fluoxetine, an antidepressant, but this choice did not appeal to him. He wanted the album's sound to diverge from Broken, emphasizing mood, texture, restraint and subtlety, although he was not sure about its musical direction. The album was made with full range and focused on texture and space, avoiding explicit usage of guitars or synthesizers. Reznor searched for and moved to 10050 Cello Drive in 1992 for recording Broken and The Downward Spiral, a decision made against his initial choice to record the album in New Orleans. 10050 Cello Drive is referred to as the Tate House since Sharon Tate was murdered by members of the Manson family in 1969. Reznor named the studio Le Pig after the message that was scrawled on the front door with Tate's blood by her murderers, and stayed there with Mom for 18 months. He called his first night in 10050 Cello Drive terrifying because he already knew it and read books related to the incident. Reznor chose the Tate House to calibrate his engineering skills and the band bought a large console and two Studer machines as resources, a move that he believed was cheaper than renting. The studio was also used for the recording of Marilyn Manson's debut album Portrait of an American Family, which Reznor co-produced. Marilyn Manson accepted Reznor's offer of signing a contract with Nothing Records. Reznor collaborated with former Jane's Addiction and Porno for Pyro's drummer Stephen Perkins, progressive rock guitarist Adrian Blue, and Nine Inch Nails drummer Chris Vrenna. Blue's first visit to the studio involved playing the guitar parts in Mr. Self-Destruct, and he was told to play freely, think on reacting to melodies, concentrate on rhythm, and use noise. This approach improved Reznor's confidence in the instrument. He found it to be more expressive than the keyboard due to the interface. Blue praised Reznor for his command of technology, and commented that the music of Nine Inch Nails made innovations that are in his realm. Vrenna and Perkins played drum parts recorded live in the studio, The tracks were rendered into looped samples. Reznor took a similar approach to recording guitar parts. He would tape 20 to 25 minute long sessions of himself playing guitars on a hard disk recorder with the Studio Vision sequencer. Most of the music was recorded into a Macintosh computer using a board and manipulated with music editor programs on the computer. Unique effects such as analyzing and inverting the frequency were applied to the tracks to create original sounds. The band would get an arrangement together and convert it into analog tape. Reznor sampled excerpts from guitar tracks and processed them to the point of randomness and expression. Among the equipment Reznor used for recording the album are Pro Tools, DigiDesign's Turbo Synth, a Marshall Rack Head, the Prophet Versus keyboard, and various Jackson and Gibson guitars. In December 1993, Reznor was confronted by Patti Tate, who asked if he was exploiting Sharon Tate's death in the house. Reznor responded that he was interested in the house as her death happened there. He later made a statement about this encounter during a 1997 interview with The Rolling Stone. Flood, known for engineering and producing U2 and Depeche Mode albums, was employed as co-producer on The Downward Spiral. It became his last collaboration with Nine Inch Nails due to creative differences. A very dangerously self-destructive, humorous short song written for the album, Just Do It, was not included in the final version and criticized by Flood in that Reznor had gone too far. Reznor completed the last song written for the album, Big Man with a Gun, in late 1993. After the album's recording, Reznor moved out and the house was demolished shortly thereafter. The Downward Spiral entered its mixing and mastering processes, done at Record Plant Studios and A&M Studios with Alan Moulder, who subsequently took on more extensive production duties for future album releases. Numerous layers of metaphors are present throughout The Downward Spiral, leaving it open to wide interpretation. The album relays nihilism and is defined by a prominent theme of self-abuse and self-control. It is a semi-autobiographical concept album, in which the overarching plot follows the protagonist's descent into madness in his own inner solipsistic world through a metaphorical downward spiral, dealing with religion, dehumanization, violence, disease, society, drugs, sex, and finally, suicide. Reznor described the concept as consisting of someone who sheds everything around them to a potential nothingness, but through career, religion, relationship, belief and so on. Media journalists like the New York Times writer John Pareles noted the album's theme of angst had already been used by grunge bands like Nirvana, and that Nine Inch Nails' depiction was more generalized. Using elements of genres such as techno, dance, electronic, heavy metal, and hard rock, The Downward Spiral is considered industrial rock, industrial, ambient, and alternative rock. Reznor regularly uses noise and distortion in his song arrangements that do not follow verse-chorus form, and incorporates dissonance with chromatic melody or harmony, or both. The treatment of metal guitars in Broken is carried over to The Downward Spiral, which includes innovative techniques such as expanded song structures and unconventional time signatures. The album features a wide range of textures and moods to illustrate the mental progress of the central protagonist. Reznor's singing follows a similar pattern from beginning to end, frequently moving from whispers to screams. These techniques are all used in the song Hurt, which features a highly dissonant tritone played on guitar during the verses, a B5 number 11, emphasized when Reznor sings the 11th note on the word I every time the B/E# is played. Mr. Self-Destruct, a song about a powerful person, follows a build-up sampled from the 1971 film THX-1138 with an industrial roar and is accompanied by an audio loop of opinion rotating. The Becoming expresses the state of being dead and the protagonist's transformation into a non-human organism. Closer concludes with a chromatic piano motif. The melody is debuted during the second verse of Piggy on Organ, then reappears in power chords at drop tuning throughout the chorus of Heresy, and recurs for the final time on The Downward Spiral. The album was chiefly inspired by David Bowie's Low, an experimental rock album which Reznor related to on songwriting, mood, and structures, as well as progressive rock group Pink Floyd's The Wall. Committer, an installation featuring artwork and sketches for The Downward Spiral, Closer and March of the Pigs by Russell Mills was displayed at the Glasgow School of Art. Mills explained the ideas and materials that made up the painting, titled Wound, that was used for the album's cover art. March of the Pigs and Closer were released as singles. Two other songs, Hurt and Piggy, were issued to radio without a commercial single release. March of the Pigs has an unusual meter, alternating three bars of 7/8 time with one of 8/8, in effect, a 29/8 time signature, and has a BPM rate of 269. The song's music video was directed by Peter Kristofferson and was shot twice, the first version scrapped due to Reznor's involvement, and the released second version being a live performance. Closer features a heavily modified bass drum sample from the Iggy Pop song Nightclubbing from his album The Idiot. Lyrically, it is a meditation on self-hatred and obsession, but to Reznor's dismay, the song was widely misinterpreted as a lust anthem due to its chorus, which included the line "I wanna fuck you like an animal." The music video for Closer was directed by Mark Romanek and received frequent rotation on MTV, though the network heavily censored the original version, which they perceived to be too graphic. The video shows events in a laboratory dealing with religion, sexuality, animal cruelty, politics, and terror. Controversial imagery included a nude bald woman with a crucifix mask, a monkey tied to a cross, a pig's head spinning on a machine, a diagram of a vulva, Reznor wearing an S&M mask while swinging in shackles, and of him wearing a ball gag. A radio edit that partially censored the song's explicit lyrics also received extensive airtime. The video has since been made part of the permanent collection off the Museum of Modern Art in New York City. Piggy uses "Nothing Can Stop Me Now," a line that recurs in Ruiner and Big Man with a Gun. The frantic drumming on the song's outro is Reznor's only attempt at performing drums on the record, and one of the few live drum performances on the album. He had stated that the recording was from him testing the microphone setup in studio, but he liked the sound too much not to include it. It was released as a promotional single in December 1994 and reached the top 20 on the Billboard Modern Rock Tracks chart. Released in 1995, Hurt clearly includes references to self-harm and heroin addiction. The Nine Inch Nails live band embarked on the self-destruct tour in support of the Downward Spiral. Chris Brenna and James Woolley performed drums and keyboards respectively. Robin Fink replaced Richard Patrick on guitar and bassist Danny Lohner was added to the lineup. The stage setup consisted of dirty curtains which would be pulled down and up for visuals shown during songs such as Hurt. The back of the stage was littered with darker and standing lights, along with very little actual ones. The tour debuted the band's grungy and messy image in which they would come out in ragged clothes slathered in cornstarch. The concerts were violent and chaotic, with band members often injuring themselves. They would frequently destroy their instruments at the end of concerts, attack each other, and stage dive into the crowd. The tour included a set at Woodstock 94 broadcast on pay-per-view and seen in as many as 24 million homes. The band being covered in mud was a result of pre-concert backstage play, contrary to the belief that it was an attention-grabbing ploy, thus making it difficult for Reznor to navigate the stage. Reznor pushed Lohner into the mud pit as the concert began and saw mud from his hair entering his eyes while performing. Nine Inch Nails was widely proclaimed to have stolen the show from its popular contemporaries, mostly classic rock bands, and its fan base expanded. The band received considerable mainstream success thereafter, performing with significantly higher production values and the addition of various theatrical visual elements. Its performance of Happiness and Slavery from the Woodstock concert earned the group a Grammy Award for Best Metal Performance in 1995. Entertainment Weekly commented about the band's Woodstock 94 performance, "Reznor on strings rocked to its horrifying, melodramatic core, an experience as draining as it is exhilarating." Despite this acclaim, Reznor attributed his dislike of the concert to its technical difficulties. The main leg of the tour featured Marilyn Manson as the supporting act, who featured bassist Jordy White, then playing under the pseudonym Twiggy Ramirez. White later played bass with Nine Inch Nails from 2005 to 2007. After another tour leg supporting the remix album Further Down the Spiral, Nine Inch Nails contributed to the Alternative Nation Festival in Australia and subsequently embarked on the Dissonance Tour, which included 26 separate performances with co-headliner David Bowie. Nine Inch Nails was the opening act for the tour, and its set transitioned into Bowie's set with joint performances off both bands' songs. However, the crowds reportedly did not respond positively to the pairing due to their creative differences. The tour concluded with Nights of Nothing, a three-night showcase of performances from Nothing Records bands Marilyn Manson, Prick, Meat Beat Manifesto, and Pop Elite itself, which ended with an 80-minute set from Nine Inch Nails. Caring described the Nine Inch Nails set during the Nights of Nothing showcase as tight, brash and dramatic, but was disappointed at the lack of new material. On the second of the three nights, Richard Patrick was briefly reunited with the band and contributed guitar to a performance of Head Like a Hole. After the self-destruct tour, Chris Brenna, member of the live band since 1988 and frequent contributor to Nine Inch Nails studio recordings, left the act permanently to pursue a career in producing and to form Tweaker. The Downward Spiral's release date was delayed at various times to slow down Reznor's intended pace of the album's recording. The first delay caused the process of setting up a pig to take longer than he expected, and its release was postponed again as he was educating himself different ways to write songs that did not resemble those on Broken and Pretty Hate Machine. He considered delivering the album to Interscope in early 1993, only to experience a writer's block as he was unable to produce any satisfactory material. Interscope grew impatient and concerned with this progress, but Reznor was not forced by their demands of expediency despite crediting the label for giving him creative freedom. He told rock music producer Rick Rubin that his motivation for creating the album was to get it finished, thus Rubin responded that Reznor might not do sound till he makes music that is allowed to be heard. Reznor realized that he was in the most fortunate situation he imagined when the album was recorded with a normal budget, cool equipment, and a studio to work at. Released on March 8, 1994 to instant success, The Downward Spiral debuted at number 2 on the U.S. Billboard 200, selling nearly 119,000 copies in its first week. On October 28, 1998, the Recording Industry Association of America, RIAA, certified the album quadruple platinum, and by December 2011, it had sold 3.7 million copies in the United States. The album peaked at number 9 on the UK Albums Chart, and on July 22, 2013, it was certified gold by the British Phonographic Industry, BPI, denoting shipments in excess of 100,000 copies in the United Kingdom. It reached number 13 on the Canadian RPM Albums Chart and received a triple platinum certification from the Canadian Recording Industry Association, CREA, for shipping 200,000 copies in Canada. A group of early listeners of the album viewed it as commercial suicide, but Reznor did not make it for profit as his goal was to slightly broaden Nine Inch Nails' scope. Reznor felt that the finished product he delivered to Interscope was complete and faithful to his vision and thought its commercial potential was limited, but after its release he was surprised by the success and received questions about a follow-up single with a music video to be shown on MTV. The album has since sold over 4 million copies worldwide. Many music critics and audiences praised The Downward Spiral for its abrasive, eclectic nature and dark themes and commented on the concept of a destruction off a man. The New York Times writer John Perelis' review of the album found the music to be highly abrasive. Perelis asserted that unlike other electro-industrial groups like Ministry and Nibsareb, Reznor writes full-fledged tunes with stronger use of melodies than riffs. He noticed criticisms of Nine Inch Nails from industrial purists for popularizing the genre and the album's transgression. Robert Christgau gave the album an honorable mention, rating and commented that, musically, the album was comparable to Hieronymus Bosch's Post-Industrial Atheist, but lyrically more closely resembled Transformers' Kitty Bourne. Jonathan Gold, writing for Rolling Stone, likened the album to cyberpunk fiction. Entertainment Weekly reviewer Tom Sinclair commented, Reznor's spit topics, sex, power, S&M, hatred, transcendence, are all here, wrapped in hooks that hit your psyche with the force of a blowtorch. The Downward Spiral has been listed on several publications' best album lists. In 2003, the album was ranked number 201 on Rolling Stone magazine's list of the 500 greatest albums of all time and number 201 on its 2012 online edition. The Rolling Stone staff wrote, holing up in the one-time home of Manson family victim Sharon Tate, Trent Reznor made an overpowering meditation on Nin's central theme, control. The album was placed 10th on Spin's 125 Best Albums Off the Past 25 Years list. The Spin staff quoted Ann Power's review that appreciated its bleak, aggressive style. It was ranked number 488 in the book The Top 500 Heavy Metal Albums of All Time by heavy metal music critic Martin Popoff. In 2001, Q named The Downward Spiral as one of the 50 heaviest albums of all time. In 2010, the album was ranked number 102 on their 250 Best Albums of Q's Lifetime, 1986-2011, list. The Downward Spiral was featured in Robert Demery's book 1001 Albums You Must Hear Before You Die. In May 2014, Loudwire placed The Downward Spiral at number 2 on its 10 Best Hard Rock Albums of 1994 list. In July 2014, Guitar World placed The Downward Spiral at number 43 in their Super Unknown: 50 Iconic Albums That Define 1994 list. The immediate success of the Downward Spiral established Nine Inch Nails as a reputable force in the 1990s. The band's image and musical style became highly recognizable that a Gatorade commercial featured a remix of Down in It without its involvement. Reznor felt uncomfortable with the media hype and success the band earned, received false reports of his death, depression, and was falsely reported to have had a relationship with serial killer Jeffrey Dahmer, and was depicted as a sex icon due to his visual identity. Nine Inch Nails received several honors, including Grammy Award nominations for Best Alternative Performance for The Downward Spiral and Best Rock Song for Hurt. After the release of The Downward Spiral, many bands such as Gravity Kills, Stabbing Westward, Filter, and Motley Crue made albums that imitated the sound of Nine Inch Nails. Reznor interpreted The Downward Spiral as an extension of himself that became the truth fulfilling itself, as he experienced personal and social issues presented in the album after its release. He had already struggled with social anxiety disorder and depression and started his abuse of narcotics including cocaine while he went on an alcohol binge. Around this time, his studio perfectionism, struggles with addiction, and bouts of writer's block prolonged the production of The Fragile, and Reznor completed rehabilitation from drugs in 2001. 1 year after The Downward Spiral's release, the band released an accompanying remix album titled Further Down the Spiral. It features contributions from Coil with Danny Hyde, J.G. Thirlwell, electronic musician Aphex Twin, producer Rick Rubin, and Jane's Addiction guitarist Dave Navarro. The album peaked at number 23 on the Billboard 200 and received mixed reviews. Recoiled, a remix EP of Gave Up, Closer, The Downward Spiral, and Eraser by Coil, was released on February 24, 2014 via British record label Cold Spring. Retrospective reviews regard The Downward Spiral as one of the most important albums of the 1990s and Reznor's greatest work. The 2004 edition of the new Rolling Stone album guide gave the album 5 out of 5 stars and called it a powerful statement, and one of the landmark albums of the 90s. Writing for Entertainment Weekly, Kyle Anderson remembered watching the music video of Closer on MTV as an adolescent and expressed that the album changed his perception of popular music from that of songs heard on the radio to albums with cover art. Stereo Gum's Tom Brann remains favorable toward the album since it is the one that most fully inhabits Nine Inch Nails' characteristics and influenced youth culture, with teenagers wearing ripped fishnets on their arms. The album was also included in the book 1001 Albums You Must Hear Before You Die. Its emphasis on transgressive themes made The Downward Spiral less lyrics vulnerable to criticism from American social conservatives. Senator Bob Dole, then the head of the Republican Party, sharply denounced Time Warner, the former owner of Interscope's former parent company Warner Music Group, after a meeting between Michael J. Fuchs, head of WMG, William Bennett, and C. Dolores Tucker. Tucker and Bennett demanded Fuchs to recite lyrics from Big Man with a Gun, because they thought the song was an attack on American conservatives by metaphorically claiming within the lyrics they had a jingoistic agenda. Interscope had previously been blamed for releasing gangsta rap albums by rappers such as Dr. Dre, Tupac Shakur, and Snoop Dogg that were deemed objectionable. Reznor called Tucker, who erroneously referred to Nine Inch Nails as a gangsta rap act, such a fucking idiot, and claimed that the song was actually a satire of the gangsta rap genre as a whole and was originally about madness. Reznor conceded The Downward Spiral could be harmful, through implying and subliminally suggesting things, whereas hardcore hip-hop could be cartoonish. Robert Bork also repeatedly referenced Big Man with a Gun in his book Slouching Toward Gomorrah as evidence of a cultural decline. The book also incorrectly states that it is a rap song. Before the Columbine High School massacre, perpetrator Dylan Klebold referenced lyrics from Nine Inch Nails songs multiple times in his journal. Klebold heavily identified with the protagonist of The Downward Spiral as a symbol of his own depression. On May 4, 1999, a hearing on the marketing and distribution practices of violent content to minors by the television, music, film, and video game industries was conducted before the United States Senate Committee on Commerce, Science, and Transportation. The committee heard testimony from cultural observers, professors, and mental health professionals, that included conservative William Bennett and the Archbishop of Denver, Reverend Charles J. Chaput. Participants criticized the album, Nine Inch Nails label mate Marilyn Manson, and the 1999 film The Matrix for their alleged contribution to the environment that made tragedies like Columbine possible. The committee requested that the Federal Trade Commission and the United States Department of Justice investigate the entertainment industry's marketing practices to minors. In 2009, Apple rejected a proposal for a 9-inch Nails iPhone application, citing objectionable content in the downward spiral. Days later, Apple reversed the decision, but refused to explain its reasoning. Notes. To mark the album's 10th anniversary, The Downward Spiral was re-released on November 23, 2004 in high-resolution SACD and dual-disc formats. Disc 1 of the album's deluxe edition re-release is nearly identical to the original version. Track anomalies such as sounds from previous tracks creeping upon start of tracks are fixed, and it includes a stereo and multi-channel SACD layer. The second bonus disc is a collection of remixes and B-sides and also includes a stereo SACD layer in addition to the Redbook CD layer. The last three tracks on the bonus disc are previously unreleased demo recordings from the original album. Dual disc, Halo 8 DVD A. The dual disc edition of The Downward Spiral contains the same CD content on side A as the deluxe edition, with a DVD audio layer on side B. When played on DVD video players, a Dolby Digital 5.1 multi-channel or Dolby Digital 2.0 stereo mix of The Downward Spiral can be selected, along with videos of March of the Pigs, Heard and an uncensored video of Closer. There is also an interactive discography and an image gallery. High resolution 24-bit/48kHz 5.1 surround sound and stereo versions of The Downward Spiral can be played on a DVD audio player, allowing the user a similar high-fidelity experience as the SACD layer of the deluxe edition. The dual disc release does not contain the additional B-sides and demo tracks. Credits adapted from the liner notes of The Downward Spiral. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.